My name is Tim Holt. I'm from Montgomery, Alabama. I started doing SI joint fusions back in my residency at Emory. I was lucky to have worked with a very good trauma surgeon, Mike Miller, and we did basically open SI joint fusions pretty much any way you can imagine. We did them anterior. We started off originally doing posterior fusions open with the big old bolts where you drove two bolts through the posterior superioriliac spine, put the nuts on them and clamp it down, pack bone graft in. Then we went from that to the way that I actually did them in my practice until I started doing more minimally invasive stuff, where we would actually place a pelvic reconstruction plate across. You open both sides, clean out the joint, drive a pelvic reconstruction plate across the posterior superioriliac spine, bend it down, put two screws in it. So as you can imagine, that's a pretty morbid operation. And as the years went by, I tried to stop doing those as much as possible and tried to make it as much of a, try to convince patients that maybe that wasn't what they needed to do. So I got to the point where I would make a patient, I would put them in a double pantaloon spica cast for 2 weeks. And I would tell them, if you can wear that cast for 2 weeks and if you get pain relief, then you have SI joint problems and then there's something we can do. Now, of course, we always did injections before that. Disclosures, I'm a paid consultant for SI Bone. I do some clinical investigation for them. I have cases, but just briefly, the way I do it, I'm a little different from some of the other guys. I do my own injections, and I was lucky. I was trained by Dr. Rudolph. He showed me all the ins and outs of this early on, and he did a great job. And I'm not saying I'm a great surgeon, but he did a great job. But I do my own SI joint injections. Because I'm one of very few physicians in Alabama who does this, I get a lot of referrals from outside areas, all the way from Mississippi. I get some from West Georgia, southern part of Tennessee, and all the way from the Panhandle of Florida. So a lot of these people get to me, and they've already had injections done, but since I'm going to buy them, I just tell them up front, I have to inject it one time. And I have to make sure that that's what the problem is. So it's kind of like a pants and suspender sort of thing, I guess. But I do my own injections. I do them typically on a single day, and I'll schedule 10 or 15 of them. And what I do is I go in, we do them with sedation, I place my needle, I inject. What I will do is bring them out, and then kind of like as Dr. Garfin was saying, I'll give them about 30 minutes, let them kind of wake up from the sedation, and then I go through the 5 provocative tests, and I see if that helps. If they've got pain relief then, I send them home, I tell them to keep a diary, come back 2 weeks later. The typical thing you see with the ones who wind up with surgery, which in my practice is probably about 20%, which is a little bit higher than Dr. Garfin's practice, but again, I'm getting referrals from a lot of outside sources. But what I typically see is most patients come back and they still have pain relief. Well, if they still have pain relief, I tell them, well, you know, you're not really a candidate for this procedure. You just need to, we'll do the injections from time to time. When they don't work anymore, then we'll discuss the other alternatives. But if they come back and it's kind of like, well, you know, doc, first 5 days, I felt great. And then I got up one morning and I put my foot on the ground and I thought I was going to fall on the floor. And those are the patients that I really think that are helped with this technique. So that's how I make my diagnosis. I make sure that, you know, that they understand what we're doing up front. And I go over everything with them clearly. My mix is pretty much the same as Dr. Pledger's. It's about probably 2.5 to 1 women to men. As far as my cases, this one is I've done about 120, maybe a little bit more of the SI bone implant. I've probably done about 250 overall fusions, including my open and my closed, open and minimally invasive. There was a period of time between the two where I actually did percutaneous fixation of the joint with a synthes screws where you just go in, you put a couple of screws across. I've since revised about 8 or 9 of those cases, because what I've found in those people, that immediately they get pain relief, and it lasts for about maybe a year to 18 months, up to 2 years. But unfortunately, you start seeing lucency around that screw, and those are the people that come back with pain. So what I do is I go back and inject them again. If they get pain relief, then what I've done is revise those. And we've had very good success with those because you've kind of done your own little trial, I think. But anyway, the first case, 53-year-old female. She's a college registrar. She complained of low back pain, buttock pain. She was treated by a neurosurgeon in a nearby community, and she was referred for evaluation for her SI joint. From a treatment standpoint, she'd already gone through all the conservative measures, physical therapy, pain medication. She'd had injections by pain management. Again, this is one of those people I told her, before I'll do it, I have to inject you. Her MRI didn't show anything significant on the lumbar spine. She had no real significant stenosis. It did reveal she had had a previous compression fracture, which had been treated with kyphoplasty, but she had been asymptomatic for years from that. We did injection of the left SI joint, gave her pain relief. On her physical examination, she had normal motor testing, and there's a slide missing here, but her CRAMS test was positive. She had a positive stork sign, which is where you get them to stand on the affected side. When they fall, they say, oh, I'm going to fall, and they start grabbing for the table. She had a positive point sign or Fortin sign. So she also had a positive thigh thrust on that side. She had a positive lateral compression test on that side. So she was taken to the operating room. I only put in 3 implants. We're lucky to be able to get away with that in Alabama. They would prefer 2, but I think that 3 is the better number. She had her surgery. She was done. She was kept overnight. And we put in the 3 implants. This just shows the AP. There's the inlet view. You can see the 3 implants are stacked nicely, well contained within the anterior wall. On the lateral view, implants look in good position. Post-op, I saw her 320-312. She was doing well, neurologically intact. She was doing quite well. She had returned to her normal activities. Post-operatively, I keep them touchdown weight-bearing for 3 weeks. And because of my practice and the fact that we do get a lot of patients from a lot of surrounding areas, typically what I will tell them, that we keep them overnight so that they can see physical therapy and get an idea of what touchdown weight bearing is. But in rural Alabama, the best way to tell them is go to a bathroom scale, put your foot on the scale. When you push down to 45 pounds, that's touchdown weight bearing. Don't put any more weight on it. Of course, usually at 3 weeks, these people show up, they're carrying their walker, wanting to know what they need to do with it. So, this just shows post-op x-ray. Again, it's poor quality film. I apologize for that, but you can see the 3 implants. And again, she's done very, very well. And you can see the previous kyphoplasty there. Second case, 57-year-old female, disabled veteran, came in complaining of low back pain. She had right buttock pain for several years. She had been treated by a neurosurgeon previously. She was referred for evaluation of her SI joint. Again, she had gone through all the conservative measures, and again, she had been injected by pain management. And again, I injected her myself just to confirm the diagnosis. Her MRI showed that she had a little bit of degenerative disc disease, but no significant compressive lesions, no significant stenosis. Her injection showed that she got good pain relief with right SI joint. Injection, again, her physical examination, stork sign was positive, positive Fortin sign, CRAMS positive, she had a positive thigh thrust. And I think that's the main thing you need to understand if you haven't done these, is the most important thing of those 5 provocative tests is the thigh thrust. You got to make sure that's positive, I think, at least in my hands. I think that's the one thing you have to make sure is positive on your provocative exam. We did her SI joint fusion 7/17/12. She had 3 implants, blood loss 25 cc's, home first post-op day. I talk fast and I apologize. We kept her touchdown weight bearing a little bit longer than usual, but you can see here we got 3 implants in. Look good. Post-op, saw her back in the office. She's doing well, and she has gotten back to her usual activity. She's a volunteer at the VA hospital, and she's back doing that now. Post-operative film just shows the implants there. That's the inlet, and then that's a good lateral. That's all I have.